And just a reminder, if counsel would please use the microphone when you speak, so that way people in the overflow rooms and people following the proceedings through the broadcast can hear what you're saying. That would be great. Okay, Mr. Brockler, are the people ready to proceed at this time?
Sure, we are.
Okay. Would you like to make some comments before you ask some of the victims to address the court?
Your Honor, I'd like to make whatever argument and comments that I'd like to make whatever argument and comments I'm going to make at the conclusion of all the statements that the victims will make.
Okay, great. Thank you. All right. And I understand that there are a lot of victims who wish to address the court. I have not placed any limits on the number of people who address the court, nor have I placed any limits on the amount of time that each person takes. So, Ms. Teach McGuire, you may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. The people call Christian Cowden.
I just wanted to let everyone know that that has happened. That happened on the day, the last day of the trial. Court services offer counseling to the jurors, and some of them may have been interested. Some of them may have not, but that was offered. That's number one. Number two, let me address some of the things that were just said by Ms. Porchot, because I think they're based on, in part, on ignorance of the law and the system, and in part, perhaps, on misinformation. It doesn't sound like she followed the proceedings closely throughout. She mentioned that she wondered what the value of the statements is after the trial. The jury was not asked to sentence the defendant on all of the counts related to the surviving victims. The jury was asked to decide what is the appropriate sentence with respect to the 12 murders. That's the only thing the jury was asked to decide. I decide what sentence is appropriate for all the other counts. So with respect to the count that involves Bonnie Kate Porchot, it is I who has to impose that sentence. That's why the statement is being made now, because it's a statement that I can consider and that I will consider in deciding what sentence is appropriate. In terms of whether it is a mockery of the system to have hundreds or thousands of years, or whether that's supposed to make the victims feel better, again, that shows perhaps some ignorance. The system says that the defendant must be punished for each and every crime that he committed. And if he committed as many crimes as he committed in this case, he has to be punished for each and every one of those crimes. The jury found him guilty of all the crimes that he was charged with. I have to punish him, impose a sentence for each and every single one of those crimes. The alternative would be to say, well, we're going to punish him for one crime but not for the other. How would victims feel if that was the system? That alternative would be worse. And so the fact that it adds up to hundreds or thousands of years is not because we're supposed to be making the victims feel better or because it makes a mockery of the system. It's because he has to be punished for each crime that he was found guilty of committing. And if that adds up to hundreds or thousands of years, then so be it. If that adds up to 12 life sentences, then so be it. But he has to be punished for every crime. In terms of there being no justice, you know, if you set up a system in which justice depends on the result, on the outcome, you set up a system that is impossible to meet. Our system of justice is not based on the outcome or the result. If it was, then almost always somebody would be able to say, well, you see, I didn't get what I wanted, therefore justice was not done. Even within the group of the victims, there would be disagreement about that, because some of the victims were apparently in favor of the death penalty and some of them were not. So if it was a popularity contest, then you could never have justice, because you're never going to satisfy everyone. Justice was done in this case not because of the outcome, but because of the process. The fact that we had 12 people who came in here and gave us their time, who worked hard, who did their best to be fair and impartial, to listen to the evidence, to review the evidence, to consider the evidence, and then to follow the court's instructions of law. They did the best they could to arrive at a decision, and they couldn't arrive at a decision in the end because there was disagreement about what sentence was appropriate. And the law says when you have a death sentence type of scenario, there has to be unanimous agreement. And I think we can all understand why the law requires that. It is the most severe sentence available, and because it involves somebody's life or death, the law wants a unanimous verdict. In this case, you could not have a unanimous verdict, and therefore it is a life sentence. I think Ms. Porcheau said that after that sentencing verdict that she told, I think, her 9-year-old or a 9-year-old that it wasn't decided yet. That's not true. Once that decision was made, once the jury came back and said they could not reach a unanimous sentencing verdict, the decision was made at that point. The determination was made. It was a done deal. Under the law, that means that it has to be a life sentence. And that was explained clearly here in court. Now, I don't know whether she talked to anyone or not, but that was misinformation. In terms of the system victimizing people again, I disagree with that. I strongly disagree with that. There is nothing about this process that has victimized people again. Now, people may have been traumatized again, and I completely understand that. I get that it is difficult to go through this. I understand, and I am sensitive to the fact that it is extremely difficult to come in here and to have to testify about the events, and later to have to testify about the impact that the crimes had on people's lives. I completely understand that, and I'm in admiration of the courage that people have shown and that the people are showing. But I'm not the one who decided to have this trial. The decision was made, and the trial took place. And if a trial is going to take place, this is what happens. This is how it goes. And it has to be people coming in here and testifying, taking an oath, and taking the witness stand and testifying to tell the, and taking an oath to tell the truth, and then testifying at that point so that the jury can consider that. That's how the system works. And then at the time of the sentencing hearing in front of the jury, it's an opportunity for people to come in here and tell the jury what impact, what harm the crimes have caused. And that's the way it happened here as well. That doesn't mean it's easy. That doesn't mean that it's not it's not traumatizing to some people. I understand that, but that's the best system we have. And in my humble opinion, it is the best system available. There is no other system like it. And, you know, if I asked you the day before the final sentencing hearing how many of you thought this was unfair, I bet you wouldn't have gotten very many people who would raise their hand and say it was unfair. And so you can't change your mind the day after just because the result is not what you had hoped or what you had expected. You're always going to have, in an adversarial system, people who are going to disagree with the result. That's the nature of our system. It's an adversarial system. But you can't then claim that there was no justice because it wasn't the outcome that you were expecting. And you can't say, well, this means that the jury did not value the lives of the victims as much as the value of the life, as much as they valued the life of the defendant. This isn't as simple as Ms. Porcheau made it seem to be. If it was, we wouldn't need a trial, right? If it was just a matter of somebody killing a bunch of people and injuring severely a bunch of people, and there was nothing more to it, we wouldn't have spent the better part of 7 months in here. Those of you who have followed the proceedings know that there was a lot more to it than that. There was a lot of evidence presented related to mental illness. Now, you can have disagreements on the significance of that evidence or the persuasiveness of that evidence, but the jury heard all that evidence, and the jury was told that it had to make all decisions based on the evidence. So this isn't a simple thing of saying, assume in a hypothetical case that someone kills 12 people and injures 70 others. What do you think is the appropriate sentence for that person, the maximum or something less? It's not that simple. That's not what our system is about. And that's not what was involved here during the trial. What was involved here during the trial was the presentation of a lot of evidence and presentation of arguments and having 12 people who were fair and impartial, having a judge who tried his best to be fair and impartial, to be neutral, to do my utmost to apply the law, and then in the end, see what the result was. And that's how you know it was justice. So, on that note, we'll take a break for 20 minutes. The court will be in recess. Thank you.
Please rise.
Let's go back on the record. This is the people of the state of Colorado versus James Egan Holmes, case number 12-CR-1522. The record should reflect that Mr. Holmes is present with the same attorneys whom I introduced earlier, and the same prosecutors are present as well. Just a couple of more clarification points. First is that I'm not trying to be critical of the attorneys in this case. The attorneys in this case are skilled, and they've been very professional. I am not privy to whatever plea bargain discussions took place. The court doesn't get involved in that. And if they had come to me and said, we have a plea agreement, I would have taken it. But likewise, when they came to me and said, we want to go to trial, we proceeded to trial. And that's exactly the way the system should work. That's how the system works. That's how it worked in this case. So that's number one. The second thing is that I think it is improper to imply, or at least incorrect to imply, that a life sentence without the possibility of parole is not a severe sentence. And I think Ms. Porshaw implied that this was injustice because the punishment doesn't fit the crime. A life sentence without the possibility of parole is a severe sentence. And we have multiple people tell us in jury selection that to them that is a more severe sentence than a death sentence. So to imply that this sentence is not a serious sentence or a severe sentence is incorrect. And I wanted to make sure the record was clear on that. Okay, with that, let's get back to the people the prosecution wish to call. Ms. Tish McGuire, who's next?
Jerry Jackson.
Okay.
I have a copy for the defense.
Great, well, thank you. All right, is it okay with all of you if we come back at 1:40? That's about an hour and 20 minutes. Is that enough time for everybody?
Yes, sir.
Is that okay with you, Mr. King?
Yes, sir.
All right, 1:40. The court will be in recess. Thank you. And thank you for the list.
Can you drive?